So, good afternoon, everybody. I am very happy to be here to represent the work of many people. This work was supervised by Gianmichele Ratto at the Institute of Nanoscience SINAR. I'm a researcher in the Institute of Neuroscience SINAR in Pisa. And to represent an image of my town, there this is day that was recently spent in on February, the last day of February. The Leaning Tower was illuminated to think that it's important to study rare diseases. And I would like to thank, first of all, Didi Lammertz, that was the PhD student that was entirely dedicated during her PhD to this project and to whom I collaborated. PCH19 is one of the known or unknown gene mutation that causes synaptic trafficking changes. And this has a readout, an altered endogenous rhythm with hypersynchronization, impaired inhibitory feedback, and the enhancement of excitation. So what happens is that there is an altered rate computation. The system responds to an abnormal way to exogenous stimuli with an impaired behavior, as the speaker before has well represented in different models. But in particular, this depends on the fact that there is a different balance of the excitation and inhibition. We know that excitation and inhibition are related to the way in which pyramidal cells, so excitatory neurons, and inhibitory cell interneurons chat each together. And as a result, we know that autism, cognitive deficit, and epilepsy have a very high comorbidity that is indicated of about an average of 30%, but sometimes it is characterized in literature that can be higher and higher with milder symptoms. And we try to study in this model, the PCH19 conditional model that was generated by Silvia Bassani and Maria Passafaro at the Institute of Neuroscience in Milano. We try to describe what happens to the brain when a single patch of the brain is mutated with a mosaicism. So the model that we produce starting from this conditional mouse model in which the exon 3 is flanked by LOXP site was to deliver a Cre recombinase adeno-associated virus. And as you can see, as you can see from this model, we created a patch with the mosaicism and we use the other controllator hemisphere as a control to understand what happened in this brain. The rest of the brain was normal. So what they did in Milan was first of all to check for the expression of PCDH19 by Western blot, and then in Pisa by Sara Migliarini and Massimo Pasqualetti, by means of in situ hybridization, they confirm that also the protein expression was altered. What we have as a result, we have a brain with a small patch expressing the green fluorescent protein, and the percentage of cells that are both mutated and both normal. We performed several types of experiments by injecting the Cre recombinase AV at P1, so early after birth, and we recorded the electrophysiology, the behavior, and by means of photobotomy imaging, the activity of a single cell by means of a calcium sensor. And now I will present the results. First of all, we saw a sudden death associated with PCDH19 mice. In particular, this effect was around P20, when there is the weaning of these mice. We don't know why that happened, but possibly because of the appearance of sudden seizure that and for the higher degree of aggressive behavior. Then we measure this behavioral phenotype by means of an automatized system that was set up by Jimmy and Federica Cruciani. And here we can see the actogram of three control mice versus three PCDH19 mice in red. And we monitor the behavior of these mice for 3 days. The first day was discarded because when the mice enter in contact with a novel environment, their behavior is abnormal. And then we take the other 2 days of behavior. You can see the white panel indicate the daytime of these mice and the gray panel indicating the nighttime period. As you can appreciate at a glance, the activity of these mice during the day is higher respect to the blue actogram, and also the activity of these mice during the nighttime period is very, very consistent. This can be summarized by this box plot, indicating that the phenotype show a global hyperactivity, and then we explore also the time spent during the sleep phase, both during the day and during the night, and we see a significant reduction of the total sleep in this model. I repeat, this was an automatized analysis, so we have a code and we can go through the data and have this data in blind. Then we analyze the activity of these mice in the anesthetized model, in the urethane anesthetized model. In this case, we know that we can understand how the brain works by discovering the different type of way of the electroencephalogram. And in particular, we can investigate delta, theta, alpha, beta, and gamma waves that are differently associated with different state of that brain. In particular, we were interested in these beta bars that were abnormal bars of activity of the brain. Why? Because if we analyze still comparing the control hemisphere versus the abnormal hemisphere, the trace of these anesthetized mice, we see that the trace indicates very well the appearance of this pulse of activity. This is not epilepsy, but is something similar to epilepsy. So I would like to clarify that we didn't see open seizure in this model, but we saw in the anesthetized mouse this feature of an higher excitability. And this is evident by extracting in the range 925 Hz, that is the range of beta bars, by extracting the number of beta bars during 1 hour. And interesting, what we see, what you can appreciate, is that the number of these abnormal activity is higher, both in the treated hemisphere and in the control hemisphere. So the ectopic activity of our hemisphere goes to influence the activity of the apparent normal hemisphere that is not, in this way, is not so normal. Another sign of hyperexcitability that we saw in this condition, in a state in absence of stimuli, was the presence of hypersynchronous events. As you can see from this EEG of patients with epilepsy, we can distinguish two different phases in epileptic brain, one called interictal phase and the other ictal phase with the proper seizure. The interictal phase are phases of hypersynchronous activity, and this is exactly what we found in our model. In the patch with mutated and normal cell, we saw these hypersynchronous events that represent time of the brain activity in which more neurons are synchronized and are firing together near the electrode, because I remember we were recording local field potential. And in particular, I would like to underline that in correspondence of every up state that are these depolarizing state of the brain associated with the micro awakening of the brain, there was a correspondent hypersynchronous event in the opposite treated mutated hemisphere with the mosaicism. Other signs of hyperexcitability were also collected in freely behaving mice. Indeed, I set up this experiment in collaboration with my colleague Laura Baroncelli of the Institute of Neuroscience in Pisa. We implanted chronic electrode, and by means of this commercial system by Pinnacle, we recorded the activity and we could still recognize beta bars that were higher in the treated patch, in the mosaic patch. At this point, we were interested also in another type of wave that is characteristic of the brain, that is non-REM sleep. The delta band is in a range between 0.5 and 4 Hz, and it refers to slow wave activity that is similar to slow wave sleep in the anesthetized mouse. So we measure the power of this delta band, and here you see a single event, a single upstate. Every upstate is followed by a period of silence that is called downstate. And we measure the power of this delta band, and we saw that there was a reduction in comparison to the power delta band in control animals, and this reduction was significant also in the control hemisphere. But, and we were surprised too about this data, if we create the loss of function of PCH19 at P60, so in the adult mouse, when we think that the rule of PCH19 has been completed, we have the same phenotype at the electrophysiological point. So we injected the AV for Cray recombinase at P60, and 2-3 weeks after, we measure the electrophysiology with the, by estimating the power of delta band in both the hemisphere at the same time, simultaneously. What we saw in rose is that in mosaic adults, we have still a reduction of non-REM sleep represented by the power of delta band. And so PCH19 loss of function affects brain even during adulthood. So PCH19 is not only a protein important during development, not strictly linked to developmental disorder, but also important in the mature brain. And this is also underlined by the fact that by doing calcium imaging experiment, we could recognize the activity of a single cell by measuring changes in calcium by using genetically encoded calcium sensor. In this case, we have wild-type cell in red expressing this JR-GECO, and yellow cell that are the mutated cell expressing both the calcium sensor and at the same time the AV-CRE with the reporter for GFP. What we found was that while in control mice, the frequency of calcium transient in normal condition is at a certain level and is comparable in the two hemispheres. So in the same hemisphere, in cell expressing CRE recombinase, so in cell that should be mutated but are not because we are in control animals, and in CRE negative cell, there is no difference, and calcium in resting state is at a certain level. If we injected CRE recombinase in the PCA19 flox mouse, we have mutated cell that are green cell and rose cell without CRE recombinase. And you can appreciate that the frequency of calcium transient is higher and higher, and this is related to a higher excitability of both the mutated cell and of the cell that should be normal but are not normal because are influenced by a diseased brain. So, summing up, PCH19 focal mosaicism causes an inducible mouse model a reduction of slow wave sleep in the anesthetized mouse, an hyperactivity reduction in sleep in behaving mice, the hyperexcitability that is characterized by some feature as beta bars and hypersynchronous events, but not in our model that is this model with a small patch by open seizure. Then there is an high variability in the phenotype, because in some animals we saw certain events, in others not, but most part of the animals we saw alteration of brain excitability. And this high variability is correspondent to what is seen in patients where the spectrum is quite different. And same results are obtained, importantly, if PCDH19 loss happens during development or in adulthood. So, in particular, I presented some data regarding alteration in sleep and possible alteration of daily fluctuation in the rhythm of these mice. And we presented the result about the behavior mouse, but also we saw a reduction in sleep in the anesthetized mouse, in particular of the NeuroREM sleep. And I would like to counting to attach to another line of research in our lab that is another research started many years ago. We are interested in understanding if the excitation inhibition balance is influenced by daily changes of excitability. These daily changes perhaps could influence also this comorbidity between autism, epilepsy, and cognitive deficit. In particular, I would like to start to pay your attention on the fact that inhibition is related to the action of GABA and GABA conductance causes different effects according to the flux of an ion that is chloride. We know from literature that if chloride is less than 20 millimolar, there is a flux of chloride inside the cell, and this causes a complexive inhibition. But if chloride is higher than 20 millimolar, there is the opposite effect. So chloride flows out of the cell, and this causes a depolarization. So also chloride can interact to change this balance of excitation and inhibition together with the classical common mechanism known. We have demonstrated that in a work that we are trying to publish is the final revision on natural communication. And what we have discovered is that there are fluctuations of chloride during the day. In particular, here you see What happens to a piece of the brain with some neurons that are blue? Are blue because they represented that chloride is a level down of 20 millimolar. But if we move to the nighttime period, chloride is higher, and that is represented by the color map in which we see that there are blue cells in a mosaic-like way, but there are also many cells, white and rose, indicated higher level of chloride. So, if chloride is higher, there is an higher excitability, as we have seen from the slide that I previously showed, because cells tend to be depolarizing. And what we set up was an experiment to test the different level of excitability of this system during the day and during the night. So we microinfuse 4-EP, that is a pro-epileptic drug, in the brain of this mouse, and with me recording in the anesthetized mouse, we measure the activity before and after the injection of 4-EP. What happens? The result is that when chloride is low, so under 20 millimolar, there are no seizure in this mouse. But if we repeat this experiment during the night, we have seizures that are robust and repeated in duration. So this is similar to what happens in patients. I found this review from National Reviews Neurology, in which they test the frequency of seizure during the day and during the night in 10,000 patients. And they saw that the number of seizures is higher during the day and tends to be reduced during the night. And this is something similar to what happens in our mice, because, you know, mice are nocturnal animals, are active during the night, and during the active period, we have a higher number of seizures. The situation in patients is a little bit complicated, as we can imagine, because nocturnal seizures are likely to be associated to sleep. And so also nocturnal seizures are important, because are 59 times higher in the phase associated with REM sleep respect to the REM sleep. There are typical form of epilepsy, for example, during the day, we can see more generalized seizure, while during the night, focal onset epilepsy. And then there are many, many endogenous circadian factors that can influence the appearance of this seizure, as like sleep hygiene, eating meals, taking medication, sleep-wake transition, because we know that during the night, in particular, there are seizures more evident around midnight or at dawn. And then, since we are interested in pediatric epilepsies, there are pediatric chronotypes that are different from adult chronotypes, because, as we have seen from previous presentation, there are hormonal levels, brain circuit, different lifestyle that can condition all these factors. So the situation is very, very complex. But, and now is our question, is there something that explains this reciprocal interaction between circadian rhythm, brain epilepsy, and sleep and cognition? And I went into the literature, and the only study that I could found, perhaps is my luck, but the only study I found about the sleep in PCH19 patients was this study published on Epilepsia 2018, in which PCH19 is associated with the broad neurodevelopmental spectrum with alteration of sleeping patterns. But this study was a study done by means of a questionnaire by asking two parents what happens to their kids during the period of sleep. And they found difficulty in falling asleep, difficulty staying asleep, restless sleep, and tired throughout the day. And the sample was only 20 patients. So another study I found is that following, in which they show that there is an alteration of REM stage with probably an abnormal networking of the cholinergic system, but still is an observational study in which they take the EEG of this patient, the polysomnography, and they find this effect. So, as a future perspective of a PCD19 study, I'm asking if it would be important to pass from parents' diary to quantitative analysis of sleep in patients. And this will be helpful to understand the mechanism at the basis of this disease, to monitor disease developmental progression and therapies efficacy. And perhaps sleep fragmentation, that is surely something that is qualitative present in this patient, could be directed, and in this way also the epileptic phenotype could ameliorate. This is a question, still something that we could do to understand better the mechanism of this disease. And finally, the most important slide, I would like to thank all the people that participate and were involved at different level in this project, specifically Didi, that now is at Radboud University in the Netherlands as a postdoc. Jimmy, of course, that gave me the opportunity to tell our results to all of you. And in particular, my colleague Laura Baroncelli, the Department of Biology of the University of Pisa, people working, people of Milano that gave us the opportunity to work on this model, and all the people working on Genesis Lab, working on circadian rhythm, and all of you for your attention.
They started actually the study of EEG and, as you mentioned earlier, during sleep. And I'm not very involved, so I don't know the detail, but definitely there is some specific pattern, and probably in keeping with what has already been shown in those other reports. And I think what you show is so important at many levels. So this complex interaction between circadian rhythm, epilepsy, and also I think on the kind of behavioral and psychiatric mobility, I think there are robust studies also, for example, in terms of disruption of sleep, circadian rhythm, schizophrenia, for example.
Yes.
And the underlying genetic predisposition that, again, maybe also beyond the PCDH19 gene. So I think it's extremely interesting. And I was wondering whether you're already thinking in terms of some therapeutic intervention to, for example, model to intervene on this chloride difference. Are you considering some?
Okay. So first of all, it will be important to monitor this sleep. I was thinking to the possibility to use wearable instruments as a smartwatch, actigraph, that can allow us to monitor the patient not in in hospitalized condition, that are not good condition, but at home. And about chloride, there were clinical trials about regulation of chloride levels with by means of bumetanide that we know can act decreasing the level of chloride, intracellular chloride. But these trials that were used for autism were stopped because bumetanide, for example, causes a lot of collateral effects since X also at Renal level. So we should think to another type of therapy modulating chloride. Another problem, we have tried this experiment of the circadian rhythm, see the results of chloride by applying bumetanide, but were done by acute administration of bumetanide, because to have an effect at the brain level, we should push the concentration of bumetanide towards toxic level. And with the 50 micromolar of bumetanide applied directly by infusion, by microinfusion over the brain, we obtain the result to revert the concentration of chloride, and we have the phenotype, the modulation of this phenotype, both in the imaging experiment with the reduction in chloride level, and both with the electrophysiology, because if we apply bumetanide before the application of 4EP, we have not seizure. So,
very, very interesting work. So, the generally accepted explanation for the developmental change in chloride levels is the NKCC1, KCC2
yeah.
ratio.
Yeah.
You have a proposed mechanism for the diurnal change, and so also in, what chloride indicator?
In this study, we have demonstrated that there is a different level of also phosphorylation of NKCC1 and NKCC2 that is different during day and during night. So this supports the different level of chloride, because we know that NKCC1, the general knowledge is that NKCC1 is more expressed during the early stages of development, and then there is expression of KCC2. Now we show that there is a modulation, a fine modulation of NKCC1 and KCC2 also during the daytime.
What's your chloride indicator?
Chloride indicator we use is a clofensor, that is a sensor that was developed in the lab of Jimmy by Jimmy, and I think that we are one of the few labs in the world to use chloride imaging of this sensor, and allow the possibility to measure both chloride concentration and pH at the same time. These experiments were done by expressing clofensor in pyramidal cell by neutral electroporation, and also by means of an AV expressive in clofensor. These are pyramidal cell. These are quantified.
I have a quick question regarding the first part of your presentation.
Yes.
So you used to control the your experimental is the hemisphere when the injection is performed, and the control is another hemisphere.
Yeah.
Have you considered any impact of this colossal projection on the
virus? Yeah. I think about that both horizontal connection and the transcalosal connection could be could have a role in this effect. And indeed, in 2017, I did a study by using a paradigm in which I induce seizure in one hemisphere, and I saw the activity in the specular hemisphere, Petrucco et al. 2017. And here we show that there is a powerful effect of the normal activity that can pass to the other hemisphere and influence also with a transient cognitive impairment the activity of the hemisphere that should be normal but is not.
Sorry, if I understand, you made a patch of a small part of the brain.
Yeah.
Is it Is there a difference with which brand you choose?
We choose the visual cortex just because we know very well this paradigmatic model. So it was the region near the lambda scissor, okay, near the midline, so the occipital part of the brain. But this was just convenient for us because we work also in the past on this model, and so is cortex, just cortex, okay.
And if I have to think about the similarities with the patient in the human, we see lots of beta activity on the EEG in patients that's often correlated with the medication. Some of the benzodiazepine really create a lot of fast activity and so on, and we see that related to the medication. That's one thing. And then the comment is the sleep-related seizures. I think, I'm not sure it's just sleep, but I think it's a certain specific part of the sleep and the transition from one phase to the next that really kicks on the seizure. At least that's what we see. So often patients have seizures on falling asleep or coming out of sleep. So there is like a transition from phase one to two or maybe two to three that really kicks in the
and seizure. Sleep wake transition are important, you see in this slide, are very important because perhaps the change between a higher to lower level of synchronicity of the brain makes the difference and is controlled by an internal clock, perhaps that work on this system. So it will be important to understand better this fragmentation of sleep, thinking to a way, for example, to improve sleep or enhance sleep, because we know very well that sleep deprivation causes effects of higher excitability, and by investigating better the mechanism of sleep, we could also understand better how to stop or to reduce or to render milder epileptic seizure. It's just an hypothesis, okay? But this could be corroborated by these results I have presented.
Grazie.